Even before the COVID-19 pandemic took hold, it had been a rough cold and flu season. But now that we're facing a protracted and potentially extensive incidence of illness, what do we need to know about managing pain? Well, let's find out from Dr. Hance Clarke. He is a staff anesthesiologist and director of pain services at the Toronto General Hospital, who joins us now via Skype from his home in the provincial capital. Nice to see you again, Dr. Clarke. How are you doing?
Pretty good, Steve.
We did a program last night all about misinformation and disinformation, so it feels like that's a good place to follow up and start tonight, because there's lots of rumors about how some painkillers react with COVID-19. So straighten us out here. A WHO spokesperson said that there's no evidence to show that ibuprofen increases the mortality rate, but they're still cautioning against it. How come?
So I think, Steve, there's been a lot of social media frenzy about this information regarding ibuprofen. I think it was clarified yesterday. WHO put out a clear statement that they're not recommending against the use of ibuprofen if you have a diagnosis of COVID-19. I think the frenzy started with the French officials that said that, you know, there may be a link to worsening outcomes. And it comes down to just, I think, how more potent it is in terms of a prostaglandin inhibitor. And what does prostaglandin do? It pretty much dampens down your immune response, in particular some of your humoral or blood responses. And I think that's where the fear came about. But I can tell you that, you know, if you're going to treat a fever, acetaminophen still treats the fever just as effectively as ibuprofen. That being said, if you're having pain, myalgias, the non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, which is what ibuprofen is, can still be used.
Okay, you mentioned this, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. That's a whole, I guess, a whole section or a whole type of medication that people can take. What about other, I guess, what do we want to call these? NAIDs? NAIDs? You call them that?
NSAIDs, N-S-A-I-Ds, yes.
Okay.
And, you know, it's interesting because there's data in other coronaviruses. For example, indomethacin, with our initial SARS over a decade ago now, was shown to have actually a positive effect at reducing RNA replication, which is the kind of virus that coronavirus is. I think the next social media frenzy is probably a result that came out today, which looks at hydroxychloroquine, which is an anti-malarial drug, and azithromycin. And the combination of these two drugs out of a lab in Marseille, France, have shown to reduce the viral load in almost the cohort of 20 people who took it by almost 100% over 6 days. So I think that'll be the next social media frenzy in terms of drugs to treat COVID.
So that's pretty successful then?
It appears to be at the moment.
Okay. Do the claims apply to other respiratory illnesses or other flus as well?
So, again, with, for example, influenza, with Ebola, with chikungunya, there was some evidence that some of the NSAIDs, like indomethacin, actually didn't do very well in those respiratory conditions as well. But with COVID so far, the moral of the story is Tylenol is your best drug for fever, and there really isn't a recommendation against NSAIDs in the current COVID pandemic.
Let me follow up on that. So you said acetaminophen, Tylenol being the most, I guess, the best known brand, still seen as safe. Why is everybody so content with that?
They're two different mechanisms. And so acetaminophen has a very central mechanism. It works in your hypothalamus, an area of your brain in particular that regulates your temperature. And ibuprofen has a larger peripheral mechanism and works at bigger prostaglandins reduction globally, and so that's why we're still favoring Tylenol for your fever if that's the symptom you're trying to control.
And you prefer that over a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, an NSAID?
For fever, absolutely.
For fever, absolutely. Okay. How about what works best if you're in pain?
Well, there's no doubt that your NSAID will be better. And so, for example, people with myalgias, the chronic pain patient in particular, many of them take NSAIDs on a daily basis. And so that was part of the fear. We had a bit of a live national tweet chat last night led by the Canadian Pain Society and Andrea Furlan and Fiona Campbell and some of my colleagues, as well as some patient partners out of Ottawa. And I can tell you that it was a pretty big topic, because some of the folks who have a chronic pain condition and have an autoimmune process associated with that can have some of those, you know, flu-like symptoms, myalgias, and it's sometimes hard to differentiate what might be a viral presentation versus a pain exacerbation presentation. And so, again, we had to, you know, calm the waters and say that at this point, NSAIDs are safe.
What if you're in pain and Tylenol isn't cutting it for you? What would you recommend?
Again, obviously, many of these folks will gravitate to NSAIDs, and I think that is safe. If you're having access to your family doc, which is becoming an issue during the pandemic and all of the social isolation that's occurring, then, you know, we can prescribe other medications for you as well.
If we can't flatten the curve of COVID-19 as quickly as decision makers would like us to be able to, I presume there will be a greater demand for the services and the products that pharmacies are stocking all over the place. And to that end, I guess people are going to be going for their Tylenol and their Advil and maybe even some cannabis somewhere along the way, or even some opioids somewhere along the way. And I guess I want to know, how prepared are pharmacies and all of the other dispensaries to handle what could be an anticipated uptick in demand?
So, you know, beyond the uptick in demand, I think the bigger fear for patients who are in need of controlled substances in particular is, you know, how can I access them? Will I be able, for example, patients on methadone or on opioid agonist treatments such as Suboxone, you know, will I be able to get my daily dispensed medications? What if I need a refill? I can tell you, Steve, I did some recent travel. I'm in a bit of isolation myself, but I luckily have nurse practitioners and fellows that can help try to facilitate some of these refills. And, you know, credit to Health Canada and Eric Costin's department and Andrea Curry and folks. And, you know, they recently sent a document around to the provinces and the territories that permits pharmacists to extend prescriptions. It permits pharmacists to transfer prescriptions among different pharmacies and allows physicians like myself to call the pharmacy and verbally extend prescriptions. And this is a big deal, because if you can't get into your doc and we don't have access to fax machines, et cetera, it's going to be a problem and patients are going to run short of their medications. And so I'll be quite honest with you. I trialed this today. I called the local pharmacy and I asked them to please extend a patient of mine whose prescriptions are running out. Unfortunately, at the ground level, they haven't heard of this yet. I forwarded them the document from Health Canada. They have put in a call to the College of Pharmacists of Ontario and are still waiting to hear the call. So I'm just, I'm a little leery that there's a gap in what Health Canada has said and what the ground level pharmacists are seeing. But it's certainly something that I have to put a call out that this gets rectified pretty soon.
Well, this is pretty important, because I know I received a letter from my doctor saying, if you got a problem, don't come in. You know, they don't. Nothing against the doctor, but you understand that they want to talk to you on the phone before you come in, because if you've got COVID-19. They don't want you infecting everybody on the staff there. But you did say something in the middle of that answer about if you have your meds dispensed daily. Why would anybody have their meds dispensed daily as opposed to just sort of get 2 weeks or a month's worth of supply all at once?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so obviously individuals who have specific IV drug use problems are at high risk for abusing medications. One of the ways you start them on the path to sobriety or the path to no longer being beholden to their substance that they're abusing is to supervise dispensing. And so that often means going into the pharmacy. So individuals who take methadone will go in daily to the pharmacy and take it supervised by the pharmacist. And so in scenarios such as that, you're going to have obviously individuals that might be at risk for not getting their medications, et cetera. And so, you know, the guidelines that are being proposed really lighten the stringency by which we're overlooking some of these controlled substances. And I think rightfully so, given the environment that we're in.
Now, I do have to ask you the flip side of that question, which is, if you've got somebody on opioids and the prescription runs out, and you are not able to see the patient face to face before making a determination as to whether or not they need that prescription refilled, and they just want you to call it in and do it, how do you know you're not adding to an opioid epidemic that already exists?
So, excellent question. I think one of the things that I'm going to give real credit to the OMA and our Ministry of Health is that for the first time ever, they are also allowing us to have telephone visits. And so I obviously, if I don't know the patient, I'm not likely going to have somebody call me and just say, hey, you know, please renew my prescriptions. But patients that I do know that may have run out and I obviously can't see them for various reasons, I can pick up the phone, I can have a discussion with Mrs. S. And she's been a patient of mine. I've been prescribing, you know, for the past years for that matter. And I have no problem calling in that prescription for a patient that I know relatively well.
Let me ask you about something that we talked about last time you were here, but I'm not sure if there's an update to this or not. You were in the midst of doing a study on the effects of cannabis on pain, and I wonder if you have anything more that you can tell us beyond what we learned from you a year or two ago.
Sure, Steve. I mean, we've got a couple things in the works and a couple things that we'll be actually looking to publish over the next while. I mean, I'll give you a story that you might know or might not know very well. You know, if we start 1,000 patients on cannabis, probably at 6 months, maybe one third of them might still be on cannabis, and there's various reasons. One might be cost might be a prohibitive issue. The second will be it's still quite trial and error to get yourself to a place where you are seeing symptomatic improvement for whatever it is you're looking for, whether that is improvement in pain, improvement in your sleep habits. For example, some folks who are looking for help with their anxiety, et cetera. And so, you know, patients need a little bit of patience to get to a place where they find these things effective. What I will tell you is, you know, for the most part, the folks that do remain on it, we're seeing a strong signal for an improvement in their pain, improvement in sleep, anxiety, a whole host of quality of life issues. And so there's a promising signal there. But, you know, one of the criticisms is for many of those that aren't on it at 6 months, we have no reason why they fell off or what the rationale was as to why they are no longer taking it. And it could just be like any other drug. It is helpful for some and not for others. And I presume that's where we will land with this. I think what we're seeing in terms of some of the patients in our hospital system is that we're seeing 20% of almost every patient population, whether it's in my hospital, for example, our transplant patients or our musculoskeletal type patients who are there for hips and knees, you know, one-fifth of those, 20% of all patients are consuming cannabis. What's surprising, Steve, is that probably still two-thirds aren't taking it or aren't accessing it through the legal measures. And so a lot of work still to do to really see where this is going to land from a medical perspective and from a social perspective.
I think you just gave us the line of the day, though. Patients need patience. That's a good line. Dr. Clarke, I want to thank you for coming on to TVO tonight and helping us out with this. Thanks so much.
Always a pleasure, Steve.
Dr. Hance Clarke, Staff Anesthesiologist, Director of Pain Services, Toronto General Hospital.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. CPA Ontario is a regulator, an educator, a thought leader, and an advocate. We protect the public. We advance our profession. We guide our CPAs. We are CPA Ontario. And by viewers like you. Thank you.